Do you find yourself scratching your head every time somebody talks about compressing and ratios and thresholds and all these different things? I'm going to simplify compression for you to apply to guitar, bass, vocals, drums, and synthesizers as well. I'm going to make it super simple. Even if you know nothing about compression, this video will explain a lot. And I'm going to use real in the world examples so that you can actually understand how this works. Most people talk about compression and they don't show you. So this video will help you get the greater picture about compression. So let's hop into the DAW. So the first thing we need to talk about with compression is which compressor to actually use. I have a 2000 something plugins. I found that FabFilter tends to have just the best run in the mill everything. Compressors, saturators, EQs, they just have the go-to stuff for me, for most DAWs out there. Okay, so if you're looking for that one company that just gets it right, this is the company. Secondly, every compressor is different. So let's listen to a guitar. And the first thing when it comes to compression is going into the compressor. So compressors are all set differently by default. They just assume that your volume is at a certain level. So the first thing is, how loud do you have to be going into a compressor for it to work optimally? Remember, every compressor is a little bit different. If I'm using an 1176 or an LA-2A, there is no threshold button. Okay, so there's only the input gain. So in that case, you're gonna have to push a sound's volume going up into the compressor for it to work. So what we're going to do here is look at the levels here for this guitar. This is played by Travis Marsh, and Todd Pritch did a session in Paramount Studios with me. Okay, so we're going to look at the values here before compression, and let's just read the average. It's sitting somewhere around negative 14-ish. Okay, so volume goes up and down. The goal of this compression that we're about to add is going to make that volume feel more linear as opposed to like up and down. And the reason we're doing this is because in a beat, the ups and downs that I want of the beat are usually the drums that dictate the ups and downs for the most part, unless it's like a rhythmic guitar. Okay, so we're just trying to get the tone of the guitar. We don't want it to dictate the groove. So we don't want it going up and down and up and down and up and down too much, because that will distract the listener from the actual drums that are doing the ups and downs and ups and downs. Okay, so that's why I'm applying this compression. Let's go into the compressor. Actually, it's boost the volume going into the compressor. So in FL, you could just do what's called clip gain to boost the volume going in. So I'm gonna turn up the volume of the guitar. Now let's open up this compressor. And now you're reading this little red line that shows you how much the compressor is actually working. Okay, so you may be asking for numbers, like what are the numbers you set your compressor to? Threshold is going to be usually around negative 18 to negative 20 dB. That's like that average sweet spot for sound. Now, if you find yourself lowering your threshold super low to grab the sound, your sound's probably too quiet going into the compressor. So you just want to turn the volume up before you go into the compressor. If it's way beyond negative 18 and negative 20, then on the individual sound, meaning not your entire mix, if it's way above negative 18, then chances are your sound is just too loud. You need to turn it down. Okay, compressors work differently, but I'm just giving you a sweet spot for each compressor. So we're aiming for about negative 12 dB going into the compressor on average. Now the ratio here is just how much volume do you want the compressor to take out. Okay, so in this case, we're just gonna have it 4:1. Here's like some general rules. 2:1 is usually around like vocal area. 4:1 is like guitar / vocal. 6:1 is like drums. 8:1. Now you're getting into harsh compression and really hard compression. And that's like bass, drums, anything that needs that snappy sound. There's no hard rule, but you know, if your ratio is super high, you're basically limiting at that point, which is a very harsh style of compression. Okay, so then you may ask, okay, now that I understand what the threshold does and how to get the volume into the compressor, how do we set the attack time and the release time? So nobody really explains this, but rhythm is the gaps in between sound. So that determines the rhythm, the BPM. What about? Okay, you have less gap in the sound when I do this, because it's the speed is faster. So let's open this audio. And let's zoom in. So in FL Studio, we have something called Edison that gives us what's called minute, second, millisecond values. So in the top right, we're going to look at this number here. Now, if I left click and drag this, it says this section that I chose is 1 minute, 53 seconds and 915 milliseconds. Okay, very important to understand what this is reading. Now, what happens if I lower this smaller and smaller and smaller? Let's go even beyond a minute. So now it says 11 seconds and 298 milliseconds. So what happens if I zoom in and I go, okay, let's say my rhythm is, and I want to measure the distance between each transient. The transient is the pointy part of the audio that dictates the rhythm most of the time. Okay, so let's look at a bunch of, like right around here dictates the basic rhythm of this track. So let's say that this is the average length for our sounds, our transients in this specific mix, this amount of sound. Now you may ask, how long is this sound? Okay, so I'll let you guess in the comments below how long this sound is. I'm going to give you a couple seconds to figure out and guess. I'm going to even let you pause the video if you want to. Guess how long this sound is in the comments below. And in your head too. Okay, so this sound is 1 second and 527 milliseconds. So let's figure out how to lower this. And let's use this sound now. Okay, because this is probably more of the average. Okay, so the average gap from transient to the tail end of the sound says 710 milliseconds. So from the time he hits that string of the guitar to the time he hits the next string is 700 milliseconds. Okay, so what can we do with this information? What we can do is actually, let me drag this back in, just that little chop that we had. So this is just the chop that we just cut from that record. It's 710 milliseconds. Here's how much that is. That's 710 milliseconds. Okay, now let's figure out how much this beginning part to the sound is. This is 233 milliseconds. Okay, this part right here. So when you're setting your compressor and your attack times and release times, you may be underestimating how long sounds actually are. Okay, and what I mean by that is you're usually told to set your compressor to like 5 milliseconds or 30 or 60. You don't realize that 60 milliseconds is, let's make this 60 milliseconds. This is 60 milliseconds of the sound. This whole sound is 710 milliseconds, but just this tiny little piece is 60 milliseconds. Just this part. Okay, so I'm breaking the myths of what you were probably assuming, that 60 milliseconds is this long thing. It's not. It's this tiny piece. So what can we do with this knowledge? So there are different purposes for the audio. So I told you the purpose for this audio, we want to make this more of an even experience. So how do I take this pointy part and make it just as low as this part down here, for example? I'm going to have to take off whatever is above my mouse and my cursor, okay, and take that volume out. So that will create an even experience in that case. Now let's say we wanted to make this a more pointy experience to where the sound is more clicky and more like snappy. That means I would have to wait for the sound to start and then turn the volume down to create a curvature. I'll show you all this when we get to the drums and stuff and the bass, but I'm just trying to explain what milliseconds are, because without that understanding, you're going to be setting your stuff randomly. Okay, so let's go back to this compressor. So now that you know 60 milliseconds is basically that small tiny piece, let's set it to 60 milliseconds of attack. And the release time, we learned that this sound is about 700 milliseconds. So let's do 700 minus 600, which gives us about 100 left over for the attack. Okay, so the release time is how long does it take for the volume go from its compressed state back to normal? So compression lasts for as long as the release time. So it's like, how long do you want this compression to last? The attack time is, when do you want the compression to actually start? Okay, do you want to capture the pointy parts of the audio? Do you want to capture the body of the audio? Okay, so we're allowing 60 milliseconds of the attack time to come through so that the sound still has that like pointy part, but then we're taking down the rest of the volume so that it feels a little more natural. Now I'm going to push the volume going into the compressor. Just listen to the difference. Now, whenever you hear that sucking motion, that's kind of what I hear when I hear compression. That sucking motion, that's when you're compressing very aggressively. So as I push the volume harder and harder in here, the compressor is working harder because more of the sound is going above that thing called the threshold. And so it's being pushed down because more of the sound is going above it. So now it's being pushed down. But it still feels even and smooth. And that's because we set the release time to the proper amount. So let's copy that value. Now let's set the release time to like 60 milliseconds and see the difference. Feels a little more jumpy on the transient energy. Let's set this back to 600. So even if your volume was super crazy, you could still give it that linear feel by making your release time the proper amount of time that it takes to get to that next rhythm. Okay, so that's why measuring the rhythm of your song is so important, because that's basically where the release time comes from. Okay, so let's move on. So that's guitar. Okay, so let's say you're not working with the guitar, you're working with like some kind of vocal chant. We have a vocal chant. And let's see here.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, this is recorded at Paramount on, I think, a Sony C800 mic. That's why I grabbed these samples, because they were recorded in the highest recording possible. So this is not stuff where it's just, recorded in somebody like this mic. You're going to hear the room. You're going to hear a bunch of stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so now working with this vocal, like little ad lib, the question is, where do we set the compression? Now, you were told to probably compress to 4 dB and that's it. I want to give you the allowance to compress more than 4 dB. So don't be afraid to push your vocal. Just modern music really compresses a lot of the sound. So let's go back to the purpose of compression in this case. The purpose of compression is to make this sound more linear and then louder. Okay, so this sound is already pretty linear. There's not like peaks and valleys and all this difference in the sound called dynamic range. There's not much of that going on. All I want to do is just take this peak, this small little tiny thing, shave it down just a little bit, and then pull the volume of everything up. Okay, so again, what's the first step? The volume going into the compressor. So let's turn that up just a little bit and let's see where we're at.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
This is at negative 20.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Let's boost this about 8 dB or so to get it to a decent spot. Let's do that.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, because you want to boost first, because you don't want to trick yourself into thinking that you need plugins that you don't need. So I'm boosting first, and then I'm asking, do I need compression? Now, in the recording space at Paramount, without going into an essay, is that it's the Sony 800 mic going into a preamp, I think a Neve 1073, and then that goes into an 1176. So even as they're recording, it's going through compression. So there aren't that many transients already to begin with when you record in a high-end studio like this. But I'm just showing you.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Stuff.
Okay. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so now we have that. Let's go into the compressor and let's set it back to default.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So all we're doing is just, you can't really hear it. All we're doing is taking off that small little tiny top part of the audio, pushing it down a little bit so that everything feels a little more linear.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Also, notice this auto gain button is on by default.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so it's turning down the volume of those top parts. And then as it shrinks the sound down, you can pull everything back up. And I'll show you what that is when we get to the drum section, because you'll understand gain a little bit more around drums.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And transient stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so again, how do you get more compression? You could either turn up the volume going into the compressor. I wouldn't recommend messing with the threshold so much, because it gets crazy when you have multiple takes.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Let's just push this
oh,
harder
yeah, yeah, yeah.
into the compressor.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so it's just making it flat and linear.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And this is such a good compressor that you can't, it's not jumpy like these other compressors. It's just very good. Now, the attack time is very fast for this vocal.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because it's just trying to make everything like flatter, basically. It doesn't need to have pointy parts in this specific audio.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Pretty basic, okay? Not much to really go over on that one. Okay, so surprisingly, vocals, you're just overthinking it because you're not thinking about the gain going into the compressor. Most people try to use the compressor to do all the work.
I don't wanna hear you tell me about how I fucked up.
Okay, so here's another, let me find.
Sometimes it still feels like you're.
Okay, so here's like a more dynamic performance. I'm trying to find the part of the audio that has the pointier parts. I want to say right here.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7.
Okay, so it's like. And then it goes back up. Okay, so let's send this to mixer channel one.
Without you.
And let's set this back to default. Again, what's the first step? We got to set the volume going into the compressor. So let's look at the average
without you, it
volume.
Feels like something is missing and 24/7 up.
So it's about negative 19 on average. Let's boost this up to about negative 12 by adding 7. So negative 19 plus 7 is negative 12.
Without you, it feels like.
Again, most people are not loud enough going into their compressor. So that's why they overly compress.
Without you.
Let's turn this compressor back on.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection. Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7.
So this has auto gain on, but let's say the auto gain was off. The question is, how much do you boost it after you compress? So in this case, we need to visually see what the compressor is doing. And to do this, I'm going to open up in FL Studio. We have this brilliant plugin called Edison. So we're going to record what's called the input, okay? And then I'm going to turn the compressor on, and then we're going to see the difference. So here's before.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection. Without you, it feels like something.
Okay, so let's record again, but this time through the compressor. Okay, so I'm going to turn auto gain off so that it's only taking out volume. It's not adding any volume back. Let's record.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection.
All right. So now we have that recorded. You can visually see the difference between the audio. The left side is before, okay? And then the right side is after. Look at how dramatically shrunken down the audio is. Now you may be asking, why would you shrink something down? It's because we want to take this pointy part that's dramatically different than the rest of the audio, and then shrink it down to like around here. So it's matching those lower parts. So it looks like the letter U almost. And now after compression, it looks still like the letter U, but less curvature on the letter U. Again, why is this important? It's because now that we have this shaved down a little bit more, those transients, those pointy parts of the audio, we can now boost the volume back to where now we're still hitting those levels that we were hitting before, but now everything is becoming louder. Not just the high parts, but the low parts as well. So I'm going to record one more take, and this time we're going to manually go in and set the makeup gain. Let's record.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection.
So we can boost it about 40 dB.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection. Without you.
Okay. So here's before compression on the left side. You could just visually see. You don't even need to hear this. You could visually see. It's very pointy, very high, and very low. Now, the second part is just compression when we turn down the pointy parts of the audio, and now we start to see more of a linear experience. Right here is when I start to turn up the output gain, so this is kind of arbitrary. But if you look towards the ending here, okay, this shape over here, this has that same type of curvature, but everything is more, it's more filled out. So look at the difference between this in-between area. It's very gappy. You see how much gap there is in the sound? Okay, so what compression is doing is letting those gaps be filled a little bit more. So now this has the same shape, but it's less gappy. Okay, it's more filled out. And that's what we're doing with this compression, is filling out the sound and making it a little more linear in the experience so that we can boost the volume and make stuff louder. So this, let's hear the difference. So here's before.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection.
Okay, now here's after compression, no makeup gain.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection.
Okay, and then here's after with compression, but then also makeup gain.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection.
Okay, so let's compare that part with the first part just to see the before and after. Here's
without
before.
You, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection. Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection.
So the main difference is when she starts singing, without you, I'm missing. And then she goes up. But this time over here, after the makeup gain and the compression, you don't hear that dip in the volume. It doesn't go, without you. It just goes, without you, I'm missing. It's very linear.
Without you, it feels like something is missing. And 24/7, I'm praying for connection.
So that's why we're using compression, is to make that experience more linear instead of, without you, everything is missing. Okay, so that's why we're doing it. So you don't always need compression, but that's the purpose of it, is to make it more of a linear experience, usually with the vocals. Okay, moving on to the next sound, we have this guitar. Okay, so you know, you've already heard compression, but let's talk about parallel compression. Parallel compression just means you have one sound, the original sound, and then you have a duplicate of that sound doing stuff. So that's all it means. So it's like having a twin brother that's crazy. Okay, you have you, and then you have your twin brother, but he's crazy. Now the crazy guy is a little off in the processes in his head. So that's basically what parallel compression is. You have a twin brother who's crazy. So here's a guitar, and we're gonna send the guitar as a duplicate over to the compressor, and we're gonna do stuff to it and blend it in with the original guitar. So now we have two guitars doing two different things. Now let's reset this back to default so we can start from scratch. Now you may hear that, now you hear that there's like a low air to the room that you might not have heard with the sound by itself, because when you send the sound as a duplicate somewhere else, you're doubling the volume by default if you send the whole sound over somewhere else. So you're basically just doubling the volume if you send 100% of that sound as a duplicate somewhere else. So you're gonna start hearing the things that you didn't hear before just because the volume's higher. Okay, so the first step is, what do you want to go into the compressor? Here's where we're getting a little exotic. I'm not gonna bore you to tears about parallel because it's more creative, but we're going to use a high pass filter so that we're not hearing this stuff below a certain point. Okay, so this is the only information that's in green. This is the only information that's going into the compressor. I'm going to mute the original guitar just so you don't hear it. So all you're hearing is the filtered guitar. If I move this frequency, you're going to hear less. So let's say you like this part of the compressor and you only want this to become, let's say, louder in this case. Okay, so what we can do is focus only on those frequencies, and then going through a compressor, we can exaggerate the compressor to pull up those sounds. So let's make this compressor work really hard. Let's set it to 8-to-1 ratio, which is pretty extreme. And let's see, our knee. Okay, here we go. Here's our knee setting. We're going to set this to hard compression, hard knee. And then let's keep the threshold where it is. But then we're going to boost the input gain. And I want the attack to be fast because I want the compressor to work right away, work, and then just basically gain volume. But you see, not a lot of the sound's going above the threshold. So I either need to send more of the signal there, or I need to lower what's called the threshold. In this case, because my send amount is maxed out, I'm going to lower the threshold to capture more of the sound. So now the compressor is working on almost all of the sound that it hears, which now you can start to hear the compressor. easier. So remember, the ratio is how much the compressor, how hard it's working. Let's set it to around 4 to 1 for now. Okay, now what I'm going to do, this is more advanced. I'm just showing you the stuff that I would do creatively. I'm going to widen the sound out with a widener of some sort. You could use Ozone Imager. You could use a bunch of plugins. So now the sound's widened. So now let's open up the original sound. And now it feels like we're in a space with the guitar player. Now let's add direct compression to our original guitar. But you still hear that low, that part of the room. So in this case, we're going to do the same exact thing. This time, we're not going to make the EQ so aggressive. We're just going to cut out everything below, let's say 80 hertz, because that's just pure rumble. We don't really need that in the guitar. Okay, now let's work on the original. Now I'm going to mute the double. Descend, and let's just work on the original guitar. Set it to about 20 milliseconds just to let the initial pointy part come through and then compress the rest. Remember, our sound's about 700 milliseconds from start to finish on average. And there's different styles of compression in this specific plugin as well, to use different algorithms. So that sounds nice. Now let's open up. And now you can turn this down. And now you have a nice guitar. So that's parallel compression. It's basically creating a duplicate of something and then doing something creative with that duplicate thing. Okay, so that's parallel compression. Now let's move into drums, what most people want to know. Now with hip hop drums, you're not going to compress that much, and I'll show you why. Because let me find an 808 for you. So here's the drums we're going to work on, and as we're listening to these drums, I'm going to find an 808. Actually, let me think for a second. Yeah, we're going to find an 808. So here are the drums, and I'll show you why compression is so important. Okay, so the drums sound cool. They're recorded pretty well. This is by AJ Hall. He recorded on one microphone. So drums, you know, without boring you to tears about how drums are mixed, usually drums have different microphones for the kick drum, the snare drum, the overheads. In this case, he just recorded on one mic for the entire drum kit. Okay. So we can compress this kind of bussing of the drums. Okay, let's create this. And let's refresh this. Okay, so now we have a clean slate. You may ask, what do you compress in drums? Okay, so let's first look at drums before we talk about what we're doing. So look how pointy these drums are. They're very, very, very pointy. With acoustic drums, you're usually going to see something like this. With synthesized drums, you're not going to really see stuff like this because of the way we sound design. Okay, but with acoustic stuff, look at all these points in the audio. Now again, if I zoom in and measure the actual pointy part of the audio from about there to there, I'd say is the pointy part. This is only 4 milliseconds. 4 milliseconds. From there to there, it's 4 milliseconds. And I think this is off. So let's hear what 4 milliseconds sounds like. Where is my thing? Here we go. That's 4 milliseconds. Sounds like hitting a ping pong ball. So that small little thing is what we're taking out if we were to compress to take out what are called the transients. So in this case, when I'm setting my attack time, I want it to go from 0 and I want the release time to be 4 milliseconds, because all I want to target is just that pointy part, nothing else but the pointy part. The question is, okay, once you target that, how much do you make it compress? So let's see the peak value here. I'm reading the values in the top left of FL. It says the peak value is -4. I'm going to write this down so I don't forget. So the peak of this specific part of the audio is -4. Now where I want to drop it down to is -15. So what is that? That's 11 dB of difference. Okay. So for every, you know, your ratio is basically 2 to 1. Okay. So that's for every 2 dB over the threshold, it pulls out 1 dB. Okay. So in order to pull out 11 dB, we're going to have to set the compressor to like 10 to 1 to get it to do that dramatic type of cutting. Okay, so let's run this through really harsh compression, and then I'm going to visually show you the difference. So let's go inside our compressor. We're going to set the attack time to as fast as possible, which is 0.005 milliseconds, and then the release time, we're going to set this to, what was it, 4 milliseconds? Something crazy. Let's do 10, to be fair. So all I'm doing is just chopping these little tiny transients off. Now what can you do with this? Again, we're going to set the ratio to really high. And if you lower the threshold, you're going to capture more and more of the transient. Now, I would never push the compressor this hard. I'm just showing you for a demonstration purpose. Okay, so let's record before and then after the compressor. So let's record like this much audio. Okay, let's go into Edison. Let's start from scratch. Record on play. Okay, so this is before the compressor. Okay, and let's get rid of this little blip over here. Okay, so we're going to record again, but this time I'm going to run it through that harsh compression, which the goal is to take out that pointy part of the audio and pull it down to where the lower parts of the audio are. Now I'm doing an extreme amount of compression here to show you what transient energy actually is. Okay, so let's open up the compressor. We want it to work right away when it hears the sound above a certain threshold, and then we want it to release right away because we don't want to turn down all of the sound. We just want to turn down just the beginning transient, which is about 5 milliseconds. But the lowest we can go on the release is 10. Okay, so I'm going to turn the auto gain off, and remember the ratio is really high. So if I want to take out 11 dB of sound, that means I need to really pull down the volume that goes above the what's called the threshold. So long story short, let's record the difference, and then you'll start to visually see what this compressor is actually doing. Look at those pointy parts are gone. Oh, you know what? I talked into the mic. All right, so I just realized what I was doing. So let's do that again. So let's do this again, my fault. But let me turn my mic off as we do this time around. Okay, so what we've done is now you can visually see on the left side, we had all that pointy information, which is important for drums. There's something about our ear that likes transient energy. I don't know what it is, but when I'm sound designing, our ear does like transients. So don't think transients are evil. It's just that, do we need all of this transient energy in the mix? Now, the reason this transient energy can be annoying sometimes is because look at the peak value right here, how high it goes. So I'm reading this, it's at -3 dB. So if I wanted to turn up the volume and compress and get loudness out of my track, I only have 3 dB of headroom to do that. Headroom is basically how much room do you have to add effects. That's basically what headroom is, okay, in my understanding and how I think about it. Now, what if we lowered the peaks to where they're at -7, -8? Then we could turn everything up 8 dB and we have a lot more room to add compression, saturation, EQ, and just gain in general. Okay, so that's what headroom is for. That's what compression can be used for sometimes, is simply to gain headroom so that we can boost up the volume. So what I'll do now in this take, I'm gonna mute my mic, and I'm just gonna crank up the gain to show you how loud we can get. Remember, the initial peak was -2.95. So what I'm gonna do is boost this signal up. It's at -18 right now. We're gonna boost it up what's negative 18 to negative 3 is 15 dB, okay? Just to show you how loud the difference is. Okay, we're gonna boost this up 15 dB. If it even goes that high, it does. So turn down your monitors just in case, just fair warning, turn down your headphones and monitors. I don't know how loud this is gonna sound, but it will be louder. And my point is, the peak value of the uncompressed volume is negative 3. But the peak value of the compressed volume can be negative 3, but it's gonna sound way louder. So dB does not always equal loudness. Okay, that's kind of what I'm trying to get at. So let's do this one more time, but this time I'm going to have the compressor work really, really hard with the makeup gain. Okay, so some of the peaks went over. So to be fair, I would have to shave this down probably 2 dB. Okay, so let's do a little alteration here. Let's do an amp adjustment and let's go minus 2 dB. Okay, so all the values are in the top left. Here we go. Okay, so for the same peak value, look at how much energy we get. You can visually see energy by how dense the sound wave looks. Look at how much density and brightness and fullness we have on the sound to the right than the sound on the left. The sound on the left is super thin, nothing going on. The sound on the right is super filled out. So let's hear all those takes. So this is before compression. Okay, now coming up is after compression. Very fast attack. Now here's makeup gain. Now you may ask, okay, you know, but do we always have to use compression for transients? And the answer is no. We have a course called the Mixing Fundamentals. Just go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. You can actually get a 14-day free trial. And I go over saturation, compression, EQ, limiting, you know, delays, reverbs. I go over all of the things about mixing in that specific course. It's my best course because I also show you how to mix acoustic mixes and hit songs as well. So what I'm going to show you here is saturation and what it can do to the sound. This is beyond the scope of the video, but I just want to show you what saturation can also do to the transient energy of a sound, just so you have a little preview. So I'm going to crank this up. And now we're going to record. I just want you to see stuff being shaved off. So look at all these points, and I want you to look at how they get shaved off after I add the saturation. Okay, so not only did we have aggressive compression going in, I just want you to see again the difference in the transient energy. So in the beginning, it was just pointy and just kind of all over the place. After compression, less pointy, but still quiet. And then this is compression with gain, makeup gain. So you can see it's more full and more filled out, but it's still pointy. And then over to the far right, we have saturation. Now saturation takes off those really thin points of the sound and it kind of squares it off. Okay, so you can see it creates this like rounded square type shape to the sound. And that's where the punch comes from. And why would we add saturation? Because it allows us more headroom to turn this back up. And it also creates a tone. It creates a sizzle to the sound because you're changing what's called the harmonic content of the sound. Long story short, after the makeup gain, we were at negative 2. Our new peak is about negative 7. So what does this mean? We can now boost this 5 dB. Okay, so let's boost this up 5 dB. Just to see how loud we can get this drum to go. Okay, so let's do 5 dB. So it's close enough. Okay, now it's, okay, so you could see here, let me start labeling these, but this is saturation plus compression. On the far right, we have here, whoops, wrong button. We have here compression plus gain, okay, plus gain. And then over here, we just have compression. Harsh compression. And then on the far left, we have original. So I want you to just listen to these. I'm going to let it run through a couple times just so you can get, you know, an idea of what each is doing. So as you can hear, once we've added all those processes, we got the max loudness. Now, is that how I'd mix my drums? I wouldn't mix it with that much compression. But what I'm trying to show you is how to get loudness out of your drums as opposed to just one compressor. It's multiple things involved with getting the max loudness. So that's where compression and saturation really add up for drums. So hopefully you grab those concepts. Let's move to bass. I'm going to move a little bit quicker here because you kind of get the gist so far about compression and how we're applying different things each time to different sounds. It's not always the same thing every single time. Let's load up the compression here. Now this is our bass take. Let me make sure this video is recording because sometimes it freezes. All right, just checking. So here's my bass that I recorded. And you can see there's pointy parts to the audio and then longer parts to the audio. So there's that thump. Okay, and then there's the long little slide that I did. So for this take, the question is, what am I trying to accomplish with the bass? I'm just trying to make sure that the thump is tame because I don't want that to get jumpy because every time I did it, it was a little bit louder, a little bit quieter each time. So I want to tame that thump. So that means I need to have a fast attack because the sound is fast. It goes thump. Okay, so I need to have a fast attack so that it looks out for that pointy part. Now, how long do I want this compressor to work? I'm just gonna assume that the sound's about 60 milliseconds. It probably is not longer than that, or 70. Let's try 80 to be safe. Okay, now ratio's 4 to 1. Now, because the bass is already like loud enough, I don't need to turn the volume up going into the compressor. And this makes it so that when the listener's listening to the track, they're not distracted by one bass going and the other one going. Okay, so that's what compressors are being used for in this case. Pretty simple, nothing too complicated. Now, remember that the compressor is only working as hard as the ratio. So one thing could go and the other thing could go. So I need to tell it how much potential volume should it take out. So that, let's say it's 5 dB over. So in this case, I want a harsh compressor because I want it to take out the max volume for that potential sound. Hopefully I'm making sense. So this is where a higher ratio would come into play. Let's take off the auto gain. Also, there's something called a hard knee and a soft knee. Let's put it on hard knee for now so it works right away. And then I have to ask myself, is it unpleasant to listen to the bass? Is it pleasant? Now, let's say I lowered the threshold dramatically. Now everything's going through. And then you can hear the compressor going. You can hear it sucking the volume away. And it just sounds overly compressed. That's what I mean by people don't think about the volume going into a compressor. Pretty simple. Bass wasn't that complicated. Let's move to the next sound. This is like a run in the park once you understand vocals and drums. A walk in the park. I said a run in the park. All right, let's send this through channel 1. Again, if you want more about this, we have a course called Mix Genius that shows you how to mix in 15 minutes. I have another course called Mixing Fundamentals, and that's my best mixing course yet. Just go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. It goes over all the fundamentals and it shows you how to mix real records from real like sessions. Okay, so let's run it through the compressor here. We have a bass. Now, just visually looking at the bass, it's very linear. Not much to like, what are we trying to get out of the bass? We're just trying to get tone out of this bass here. So first thing we need to do is set the volume going into the compressor. So let's turn it up. Okay, so we want that thickness sound to fill out the low end. I want it to be a pretty fast attack because I want the compressor to work right away. It's not a very transient, heavy type of sound. And then I want it to just hold the volume until the end of the bass. So this bass probably rides out for it. Let's measure it. Let's not guess. Let's actually go in and let's edit this audio. So I'm just saying the average bass lasts from here to here. So how long is that? That's 980 milliseconds. So I want the compressor to lower the volume, hold it, and then release right at the end. So let's say we want this to work about 950 milliseconds, which is close enough to a second. So that's a pretty long release time. Let's let this ride so you can hear the different bass takes. Now these different algorithms can give you saturation, but we're just going to use the clean one. Now I'm going to show you a little sneak peek. How do you get the rumble out of a sound? It's usually creating what are called harmonics through what's called saturation. You could also switch this to what's called a transformer. This is also pretty cool on bass. You hear it go wow, just like kind of washy sound. It's because we're adding more harmonics. Now, if I exaggerate this, you're really gonna hear. So sometimes your sound just needs more harmonics. It doesn't need to be compressed more. If you want it to vibrate, that's where saturation comes into play. And this is what some analog compressors would add as well, is that harmonic content. You can even see visually with the level here, it's like very flat. And that's what the compressor is doing, just making sure it's flat so that I can keep it at one level and have my drums doing one thing and then, you know, this doing a different thing. Let's see if I could. These are two different tempos. This is 87, so let's do, let's tap it out. I wouldn't even know what this tempo would be. Probably 88. Okay, so what I'm trying to do now is show you how important that leveling that bass would be when you have drums. Okay, so at least I can visually see. So we're just going to time stretch this. It's not going to be perfect because I don't have time to go into perfection here. Close enough. Okay, so we'll time stretch that. So this is an in the field example, and this is why I'm doing this, is so people could actually see not just the theoretical parts of compression, but how do we make this sound right in context, and why even compress? So that's the bass. Let's open up these drums. We're at 88. Let's just lock it to the BPM. Let's lock it down to 87. Okay, so let's make this drum and the bass work together. Okay, so the first thing is we have the bass nice and full and it's nice and linear. But the drums are like papers compared to this. Let's hit Control L, send the drums to a new mixer slot. Let's start applying all these techniques. Now for these drums, instead of going straight into a compressor, I'm going to use a saturator to chop off the transients instead of using the compressor to do it like we did before. This will also create harmonic content for us. This is why I showed you saturation with our drums. You can hear that crunch. Let's add the compressor now. I like my drums around 30 milliseconds and 100 milliseconds release. Remember, the volume has to be high enough going into the compressor. So now we can push the volume going into the compressor using what's called the output volume from our plugin before, which is the Saturn. So if I want more compression, I would just pull up the output gain until I get the tone that I'm looking for, the feeling that I'm looking for. kind of like that creamy feel. And now you can take off auto gain and just manually do it. Now leveling, I'm going to turn up my headphones so I can hear the difference here. Right, so that's where I would probably have it set. Now, that's quickly just leveling. I would do a lot more to the drums. Remember, that's one mic of the drums. It's not all of them. So this video is going on some time. I'm going to skip to the 808 I talked about.
3-4.
Yeah. We'll skip these vocal ones. I think this is a vocal. That's bass. Okay. Lastly, I talked about synthesizers. So what is the goal of our compression with the synth? Our goal is to just make it nice and even. Okay, so for this synth specifically. And also, I'll talk about problem areas in this synth as well. So let's pull up the compression. And if the goal is to make it even, look at the waveform. It has a pointy part, then it goes flat. So in this case, I just need to capture the pointy part, shave it down a little bit so that it matches the rest of the flat part. And let's say it's 40 milliseconds of a sound. And then I could turn up the sound to match the rest. Now again, what's the first step? The input gain. Let's just turn it up. So now the synth feels nice and uniform. So here's before. Sounds cool, but it's not full. Now here's after. See how it feels much more dense? And that's why mixing is so important, because amateur producers would go in and add more sounds and make it more complicated, when in reality, all they would have to do is just compress the sound to make it bigger. Let's say you have a problem area. This is where multi-band compression comes into play. So let's say there's a little too much energy. You can see this is like a little hill. So the top of the hill is how much energy we have. So let's say it's too much in this zone right here. And you want that to be tamed. So what you could do is use a multi-band compressor, okay, to kind of tame just this frequency range. Now I'm going to exaggerate this for just teaching purposes. But as I compress it more, we're taking more and more of that frequency range out of the sound, and it's less, I'll say, muddy. Some would say cleaner. So let's do before and after the effects. So here's before. After. And this sounds so dramatically different. I'm going to record this just to show you the difference. So let's record without the effects, and then let's go with the effects. So here's this. Let's record. Okay, so now we can visually see, did I capture that transient? Not necessarily. So looking at this waveform, the transient was 144 milliseconds. I only set it to, I think the compressor was at, let's see, 40 milliseconds. So now let's do it at 140 milliseconds to capture that entire transient. And let's record one more take with the compressor aiming to take out the transient this time to make it a little more flat. Again, flat sounds aren't necessarily better sounds. Just want to make that clear. I'm just showing you what compression can do. Okay, let's record one more time. Now this time it's with a longer release time, okay, meaning that it's capturing more of that transient in the compressor. Also, let's make this a hard knee so that it works right away. Let's do this again. So if you still see points, that's because your threshold's not low enough. Okay, so I'm getting visual feedback to help you understand compression. So now what we need to do, if you really want to shave down those points, we either need to lower the threshold or raise the input volume. So let's lower the threshold. Okay, now let's see the difference here. And also the ratio, how much volume are we taking out? It's negative 12 dB to negative 16. So 4:1 is good. We don't need a lot of compression here. So let's record one last take with a heavier compression setting. Still have that point, but it's more of a linear experience. All right, so let's hear all these. Now this is with auto gain. I didn't do gain, my own gain. So let's see, negative 12. And this is negative 15. So technically we could boost this about 3 dB to match levels here. Okay, so this is the fully compressed sound, very harsh. And let's play all three. So it's before, and then compression, and then harsh compression. Okay, so I like the middle one the best, but it depends on what type of song you're doing and how hard the sound needs to be pulled up front. Okay, so those are the main ways to use compression. If you want to learn more, again, I have a course called The Mixing Fundamentals. Just go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. I'll leave a link below, but again, it's on our website at premium.busyworksbeats.com. It's called The Mixing Fundamentals. And in that course, it will teach you compression, EQ, saturation, limiting, clipping, how to make stuff louder, wider, all these different things, and make it super easy for you. Thank you for watching. Like the video, share with a friend. Peace.